Southwestern Oregon is a dream world, a land of incredible beauty, of tall trees and mountains rising from the sea. It's the home of Southwestern Oregon Community College, which 20 years ago existed only in the minds of a few determined people. It seemed the impossible dream. The story of Southwestern Oregon Community College is the story of people, longshoremen, loggers, millworkers, farmers, homemakers, and businessmen, as well as educators and students. This is how it was born and how it grew, the history of the college, in the words of the people who built it and lived it. One of the men who made it happen was a longshoreman and labor leader named Henry Hansen. Carl Gaylord, who served for 11 years on the College Board of Education, remembers him this way.
Henry, of course, is very frequently and properly credited with being the spark plug, the human being whose own personal enthusiasm and doggedness and determination ultimately culminated in the college being here. He dreamed of this college. He believed in it so completely that despite a million discouragements, he never let loose and never stopped.
When I was in the Army, I talked with guys from all over the United States, and they had junior colleges. Even Alaska and Hawaii had junior colleges, and they weren't even states at that time. But Oregon didn't have any. So when I got out, with the support of my union, the ILWU, I went and made a presentation to the Oregon State Legislature. And we did manage to get through a fairly good bill with some effort. Petitions had to be prepared and circulated. So Jess Laird and I went to the Coos County Fair. We put up a tent, signs, and an exhibit. There were all those farmers from all those school districts who signed petitions, with their wives, of course. During the winter, we went around the districts and handed out material and answered questions concerning the formation of a community college district. We got 5,000 signatures from Florence to the California line.
But the battle was far from won. There was organized opposition. A group got an injunction to stop the effort, charging that the title was insufficient since it called for establishment of a community college instead of a community college district. Henry Hansen returned to the legislature to continue the battle.
We finally got a new law put together. A lot of patches and whatnot. And I hurried up and got a couple of thousand more signatures that the new law required. And we had ourselves a community college district and five elected directors.
That's how it all began. This pioneering legislation made it possible to have a college in Coos Bay, but what's more, it was the foundation of the entire community college system in Oregon, now a total of 13 colleges around the state. But you need more than a piece of paper to have a college. You have to have a campus. Hansen became a member of the first Board of Education and went before the City Council of Empire, which donated land for a campus on Empire Lakes. It was a swampy wildwood, a logged-over area grown up in a tangle of brush. Dr. Wendell Van Loan was hired as first president of the college that had no campus, no books, no teachers, no students, no buildings to call its own.
We had been interested in the community college movement from its very beginning. California, Washington were way ahead of us, and we had been feeling the urge to get Oregon involved in community college work. So when the opportunity came to participate in the development of the first community college in Oregon, located in Coos Bay, we were very much interested in doing it. And that came in the spring and summer of 1961.
Don Moffitt, now chairman of the business division, was hired as first business manager of the college. A budget was set up in June so the college could open in September. Moffitt set up the books, bought equipment, and the school opened September 25, 1961, with an enrollment of 266 students. Dr. Lillian Van Loan was director of counseling and recalls the first registration day.
And I'll never forget the first day of registration because it showed that the dreams that we had of a college in a community such as Coos Bay were justified. The young people and the older people who came in that day were different in attitude. They were eager. They were enthusiastic. They wanted you to help them get started. People who said, I've dreamed all my life of going to college, and now it's here and I can go. Well, it was just a thrilling day.
During the early years of the college's existence, classes were held in surplus Navy facilities and local schools. An old hotel was the first administration building. The president's office was an old potato bin. Dr. Ronald Lilienthal was a member of the first faculty and attended the first commencement ceremony.
The one thing I can remember, it was in the gym, and we had loudspeakers. The amplifying system had a tendency to pick up the transmissions from the air terminal that was right next door. We not only got the graduation speaker, but we also got the landing instructions and the weather forecasts that were coming out over the airport transmission.
While the classes went on in begged, borrowed, and rented facilities, construction got underway on the Empire Lakes site. Harvey Krim, college business manager, remembers it this way.
We started building almost as soon as I got here. We started clearing the campus that summer, which was 63, clearing, bulldozing the roads to get into the place, and it was a miserable place to get into. You couldn't see a cotton-picking thing because the underbrush was about 10 foot high. The first time Wendell Van Loan ever brought me here, we walked down a blazed trail. You couldn't tell anything until you stepped into the lake. You couldn't even see the lake until you got there. It was a mass of brush and mud holes. That's about all it was. In the first phase, we built Randolph Hall, which we called then the Technical Vocational Building, and Umpqua Hall, which is the automotive shop.
And the automotive building was not just for autos. Every building served double duty. Home economics instructor Benita Stender had her sewing class present style shows to display the fashions they created.
probably one of the first ones we did was the automotive building. When it was a brand new building, we had no other place to hold programs on campus. And I can remember setting up a fashion show in with the machinery and the pipes and setting up a stage and a platform. And that was probably the beginning of my realization that women in the community wanted to be involved in the college activities and were eager to turn out and eager to find out more about the offerings. And from that early beginning of the fashion show at the automotive lab, we then went on to the first women's program and then to other programs.
Classes moved in while construction continued. There was dust everywhere, except when it rained, and then there was mud everywhere. Brunel Meacham, Professor Emeritus of Journalism, remembers it this way.
Students who came out to that campus the first year frequently encountered difficulty with their cars getting stuck in the mud because the roads really weren't all that great out there. All the women faculty members who taught in that business building, when they would come over to the other campus near the airport, they wore boots on the Empire campus simply because there was mud sometimes up to their ankles, and none of us were on the North Bend campus were all that excited to get over there until they put some walkways in.
Randolph, Sitcom, Colito, Delwood Hall all were named for pioneer post offices. How were the names selected? History professor Bob Croft recorded an account of the naming process before he died.
I was instrumental in getting the establishment of a Name the Buildings Committee. I served on that committee. I was determined that no buildings would be named after people. I just think that it's better to give recognition to things that cannot really be duplicated. And our buildings are named after defunct post offices, and their chances of being duplicated are almost zilch.
One of the students who enrolled for classes in the early days of the college was Dr. Sheldon Meyer, now a member of the Board of Education.
It just seemed like every year that SWOC was in existence, there was a new beginning and a new birth, and with that I think comes new energies, and if a direction needs to be applied to it, it's probably an upward energy, and it just felt like we were all part of a becoming, and that's exciting. There hadn't been written a manual yet as to how to open a community college and run it, and so none of us knew exactly what to do. We just did what felt right, and it worked out.
The college was accredited in 1966 by the organization now known as the Northwest Association of Schools and Colleges. During the fall of 1967, Prosper Hall was built for physical education and sports. Tioga Hall was completed in 1969.
The way Tioga Hall was built was kind of interesting. They built all the floors at first, a la beehive, and then they put the walls up last. The walls were poured pre-stressed on the ground, and then they hung them up there with a great big cherry picker and welded them into place. Effectively, they all had a metal stud sticking out, and they just welded them right into the floors that were sticking out on the building.
And inevitably, the rains came. Jim Bedingfield, first college attorney, describes the trauma of Tioga Hall.
The building was built in two stages. Mm-hmm. That was another crisis. The roof was off of the building when they were getting ready to raise it, and they were still using the lowest levels and had books and magazines and everything in it. Tremendous storm hit, and there was water running down the stairways just like a creek, and there was a real flap over that. President Brookins at that time called up the contractor and told him about it, and he said that it was destroying all these publications and ruining the ceilings and the paint and the carpets. And So the contractor, who was from Salem, as I recall, sent his son and another young man down with a truckload of tarps, and they drove up in this driving rainstorm and unloaded the tarps in front of the building and went back to Salem.
Three temporary buildings were constructed in 1973 and 74 to provide spaces for nursing classes and machine shops. One of the first industrial mechanics instructors was Wayne Andrews.
We had young fellows who were just out of high school who were working someplace in the daytime, mm-hmm. some of them right in the trade, but most of them at other jobs, and they were going to school at night. The students at that time were interested in going to school to improve their skills, and they had to be dedicated to come right from work almost without supper and put in that whole early evening hours. Well, not too early either. Sometimes we go ran till midnight to get something done.
Empire Hall was dedicated in 1980. It's the living room of the campus, with a cafeteria, quiet study room, student publication room, and offices for student government. Classes held for many years in temporary facilities will soon have a home of their own. Now under construction on the campus is a lab shop complex, which will provide adequate space for art, music, home economics, nursing, forestry, welding, and machine shop. Today, the college campus teems with life. More than 5,000 students attend classes each term, men and women of all ages. Day and night, they come to the campus to study, listen, learn. They explore the sea, the earth, the stars, and the mysteries of the human mind. Some are taking the first 2 years of higher education. Some are training for a job or career advancement. Some are learning ways to build happy homes and families. Phil Button, one of the first students, reflects.
An awful lot of these people are working local in the community today. Obviously, it's been good for the community, because a lot of them get their year or two, or maybe even their 4 years, and come back into the community rather than go somewhere else.
The college trains local men and women to fill local jobs. The college district covers almost 2,000 square miles, an area larger than the state of New Hampshire. More than 70,000 people live here. More than half of them, 48,700, have attended SWOCC classes. You meet these former students everywhere, in schools, offices, business, government, in auto shops, wood products industries, the construction trades and farms, on fishing boats, and in executive suites.
Van and I open our mail and find a letter every once in a while, more often than I ever expected it, from a young person who today is successful, who remarks that but for Southwestern Oregon Community College, they wouldn't be where they are today. It was that little school that gave them the start.
An additional 15 to 20,000 come to the campus each year for special events. They attend concerts, plays, movies, games, lectures, art shows, and other events.
When I decided to come to Southwestern Oregon Community College, I asked to hear about it from an unbiased and impartial and detached observer. So I asked Jack Bookins. And he told me that 40% of the students attend classes during the day, 40% during the night, and the rest are here all of the time.
Outreach classes have been offered in towns throughout the district: Bandon, Coquille, Myrtle Point, Reedsport, Powers, Lakeside. SWOCC is home to many people. It's small enough so that one person does make a difference. It's large enough so each person can find opportunity. It's a community of students, faculty, administration, and board members devoted to a common purpose: gathering, sharing, and using knowledge for individual growth and public benefit.
Obviously, the most important contribution of the college is its availability. Governed at a local level by local citizens, to be in a position at all times, as best it can, to serve the needs of the community.
It's different now than it was then, because I think it has taken on a lot more permanence. It's good to see the buildings. It's good to see the stability. It's good to see the growth. Back in the beginnings, it was always very tenuous as to whether or not we were going to make it through the year before the old gym out of the airbase collapsed. The growth has been good. I think stability is the one thing that's changed, that it feels like a campus now. When I go out there, there's an aura. SWOCC has a history, and a history is important because it allows us to predict. The best predictor is historical data. And it's been successful, and it's been moving, and it's been growing. And I see that as the future as well.
People accept the fact that they can grow intellectually, physically, as long as they're alive. I talk with students now whose children have come here. The children have gone through the program of their choice, have gone on to other schools or careers. Now the mothers are coming back, and maybe their grandmothers will come back. And it's accepted among the members of the family that SWOCC is a place to go if you want to grow.
Well, I think that really is of primary importance to maintain the thrust of SWOCC, if you will, of reaching to the community and doing those things for the community which they want done. And I think that all is not doom and gloom, that SWOCC has potential. They have the talent, you see. There are other factors that interfere with that. And it would seem to me that SWOCC, while it's not in an enviable position at the moment, it can't be stopped. The SWOCC's not going to die, and it's not going to go out of business. They don't have its good days and its bad days. As the old heads disappear and you infuse new and young blood, that may be most beneficial to SWOCC. We see vocational, career, and the liberal arts come together, and then we see them drift apart, and then they come together and drift apart. And part of it is involved with personalities, and part of it is just cyclical, I suppose. I doubt very much that you can ever get the ideal situation where everybody is one big happy family, but certainly it's a goal worth striving for.
This year, Southwestern Oregon Community College celebrates its 20th birthday. Your community college is an educational resource, a cultural resource, an economic resource, and a recreational resource. It provides community dividends on your investment. Our primary function is to help citizens of the college district, our human resource, to develop themselves to their fullest potential. We were established to help people learn to read, write, compute, speak, listen, understand, think, work, and perform. We are concerned with work and leisure, with truth, beauty, and justice, with nature in all its forms, and with values and attitudes, knowledges and skills. We are a people's college, a boundless resource for the people of Coos and Western Douglas counties. You are invited to visit the campus at any time, tour the buildings, talk to our faculty, staff, and students. Your active participation has helped to mold us into the institution we are. Your continued support will help us to help the people of our district to grow and learn and realize their potential.
These have been some of the highlights of 20 years at SWOCC, but the college was born much earlier than that. It existed in human hopes and dreams. It's a link between past and future, built by men and women who worked and fought for educational opportunity for our children.
Every now and then, when the world steps in, stealing all our time away, it soon takes over. We forget to touch. That's when I know it's time for me to say, take my hand, let's walk through love's door. Hearts are free,
and the time is ours to share. Love.